Okay, welcome to the show, Steve Malzberg Show indeed. And you may be wondering why me, Rick Unger, is sitting in Steve's chair today. No, it's not the April Fool's Day. It is, in fact, Labor Day weekend. And yes, it is a liberal filling in for Steve Malzberg. How does such a thing happen, you ask yourself? Well, first, let me promise you that here at Newsmax, they are equal opportunity employers and they are willing to give a liberal a shot, even if they disagree with most of what I say when I'm here every day as a guest. I promise you it's not gonna hurt, no flipping, no changing the dial. You're gonna get a great show, and who knows, at the end of it, maybe we'll all know each other just a little bit better, and isn't that the point? Right? Okay, let's start by turning to what's clearly the biggest story of the day today. British Prime Minister David Cameron has raised England's terror level to severe and told the world he plans to take on radical Islam at home and abroad.
We've all been shocked and sickened by the barbaric murder of American journalist James Foley and by the voice of what increasingly seems to have been a British terrorist recorded on that video. It was clear evidence, not that any more was needed, that this is not some foreign conflict thousands of miles from home that we can hope to ignore. The ambition to create an extremist caliphate in the heart of Iraq and Syria is a threat to our own security here in the UK.
So Prime Minister Cameron's views on terrorism appear to be much more aggressive than anything that we've heard so far coming out of the White House. So you have to ask the question, is the president going soft on radical Muslims like Hamas, like ISIS and Al-Qaeda, or does he simply have a more secret strategy, if you will, that he's not yet ready to disclose to both our friends and our enemies? Or is he possibly goading our allies to get them a little bit more involved in what we might be doing in the days and weeks to come? To try and answer some of these questions, I'm joined by Jonathan T. Gilliam, CEO of United States Continue Services, LLC, and former U.S. Navy SEAL, not to mention former special agent for the FBI. Jonathan, welcome to the show.
Good to be here.
You are so many formers. You just don't look old enough to have done so much. It's unbelievable.
I get bored easy. That's what I always
say. I see. So what do you make of what the Prime Minister had to say today? What's going on over there?
Well, I tell you, it's very interesting how we have two allies, the United States and Great Britain, who are so different in the way that they've come about to talk and attack this problem. And I don't buy necessarily what you're saying there a second ago about the strategy that Obama and his administration. Well, listen, we actually agree more often than most people think.
We do agree a lot. That's right.
But I think in this case, if you look at Syria and the way they handled it before, they had little strategy there with Secretary of State Kerry. That didn't play out too well. And I think he was telling the truth yesterday. I know the chance is there because he likes to use special forces and smart bombs to wage these types of battles. But I have to believe when he says we have no plan.
Well, when you compare the way the Prime Minister Cameron over in the UK approaches this and the way President Obama approaches it, are you convinced that the difference is in substance versus possibly a difference in style in the way they present?
Right. Well, we will always have a footing. We always have some type of a war footing. You know, the FBI and the different federal agencies here at home always have a footing and realize that things are going to be happening. It's not like they have to spin a plan up, you know, at a moment's notice. But the, you know, perception is reality when it comes to enemies like ISIS, and playing poker with them doesn't work because their agenda is forward.
Right.
And I think that, Prime Minister Cameron, when he said that, I think that he's setting the tone. And, you know, Israel sets the tone. Countries that succeed against enemies like ISIS, they set the tone. They don't allow ISIS to set the tone because you don't want people like that setting the tone.
Well, relevant to today's announcement over in the UK that they were raising the terror level to what is actually, when I first heard it, I thought, wow, this is the highest level. It's actually the second highest level. They have one that goes a bit up. What do you think precipitated that? They've said that they have no information of a specific plot, but obviously something is going on that has caused them to react in this way. Do you have any sense of what that might be?
Well, my first thought is that, you know, they have a British guy that just killed a reporter
right. For
ISIS. And I think that was very alarming. I think a lot of times they change these terror threats publicly to comfort people and say, hey, we're amping this up,
yeah.
We're on it. The reality is we're always under a threat, whether it's a known threat or not a known threat. And I think, you know, that may be part of it. I think there may actually be people who were shaken by this. And when they started to dig in it, the numbers truly came out of how many people are being recruited and going over there.
Well, I have to tell you, a thought came to my mind when I saw this, because I'm aware that the Brits have been pretty effective lately breaking up some very large Al-Qaeda plots. And my first thought was, I wonder if Al-Qaeda is getting a bit annoyed by all of the press, all of the attention being focused on ISIS. Is it possible that they are planning something very large in the UK to remind everybody, hey, we're still here?
Could be, or it could be, since they broke those up, they got more intel about ISIS.
What might be coming.
You know, what could be coming. I think the difference from what I'm seeing between ISIS and Al-Qaeda is that they you know, they're two different baseball teams in the same league, basically.
Right.
And they're just competing for who's, you know, going to win the pennant.
It does seem that one of them is more the Yankees. They're far better funded.
Right.
They've been running a pretty clever business. You look at what ISIS is doing. I mean, not only do they rob a bank and take away $400 million, but they're making a couple million dollars a day on pirated oil.
Right.
They're making money extorting people in the towns that they've taken over.
Right.
They're running an extortion racket, paid protection.
And that's what they do. You know, when we look at...
Al-Qaeda didn't do those things.
Well, it's in the Al-Qaeda training manual.
Is
but
it?
Here's the difference. If you look at the Al-Qaeda training manual, it's like organized crime 101. I mean, everything you go through there, extortions, robbery, kidnappings, you know, all the money laundering, it's all in there. Prostitution, even, and drug dealing. It's all in there. But... the thing with Al-Qaeda was that versus ISIS is that, you know, Al-Qaeda suffered from, I think, the same problem that we suffer from in our government, which was a hierarchy that wanted to rule and wants to command everything that's going on from above. And a force like ISIS is on the ground and in the fight. And I think you're going to see a lot more of an aggressive move from ISIS, and Al-Qaeda's kind of been left behind to the point where if you look at what ISIS stands for, Islamic State, you know, that's what Al-Qaeda was pushing towards. Now they just had a group that just stood up and said, hey, we're Islamic State.
Well, you're pretty well trained in these things. So let me ask you to do this. If you were going to put Al-Qaeda on a danger scale from 1 to 10, and you would put ISIS on a danger scale 1 to 10, what would those be?
They'd both be 10.
They'd both be 10. You still think Al-Qaeda is every bit as dangerous to us as is ISIL?
Al-Qaeda still has the ability and the means and the motivation to carry out an attack. ISIS, we know they have the money. We know they have the manpower. And we know that they're motivated to come into the country and do smaller attacks, whereas Al-Qaeda didn't typically. That's why we didn't have, I think, another attack for so long, besides the fact of us thwarting several attacks. I think that Al-Qaeda was constantly looking for the big attack. ISIS are individuals who would probably get people over the border and come in and hit malls, religious institutions, different tall buildings, you know, but in a different way, not necessarily flying a plane in, but just standing outside and waiting for people to go to work. Stadium and arenas, those types of things. Like the Boston bombing is very similar. That's their style of attack.
Will it require changes in how we defend? I actually believe that we have done a pretty good job these past number of years in defending on attacks on the homeland. I can't believe that no one's tried. They've tried. I think we've done well in stopping it. Do you think it takes a different manual, if you will, when it comes to ISIL, or will the attack approach be pretty much the same as what we've expected?
I think we've been successful because of sources, not necessarily because of what we've done.
We're better information.
The way we're set up, as far as law enforcement goes, is very responsive. Military, we're very direct action, and we move forward on any type of information we get. Law enforcement, you know, we do a lot of response.
Right.
And I think the Boston bombing, again, is a perfect example of that. You know, these are individuals that were trained somewhere else, came in and picked out the exact place that I, as an unconventional warfare expert, would have picked. The end of a marathon is one of the biggest numbers of groups of people you're going to get. It's every year. It's televised. Boom, they hit that.
Even though that kind of an event is swept, if you will, ahead of time to try and keep this from happening.
You notice they picked the Boston Marathon and not the New York City Marathon. New York City Marathon is very locked down at the end.
Interesting.
still doesn't mean they couldn't get in there, but comparatively speaking, the Boston Marathon, from what I saw, there was no, you know, taking of backpacks. There was no, you could walk anywhere you wanted over there, and that's what they did. They exploited that vulnerability.
All right, so now we know we have this ISIL situation. You don't really believe that the White House has no strategy. I mean, you're a military guy. You know the military is always ready to react on a moment's notice. If they got called in to go tomorrow, they can go. So why is everybody putting so much credence and credibility into that statement yesterday of the president's?
Well, you know as well as I do, perception is reality. I mean, I think we saw that in what happened in Missouri a couple weeks ago. You know, how you react to things doesn't just set up the tone for if you're wanting to play poker with a bad guy, but the country's morale has a lot to do with that. And now people are looking at the Prime Minister over in Great Britain and saying, wow, they really have it together.
But does that make the country feel better or worse? Which I think, you know, you made a fascinating point. You said that one of the reasons they might do that is to give people a sense of security, of feeling better. I don't know. When I see the terror alert go up, I get more nervous.
Well, see, I think that's good that you get more nervous because you become more aware. And that's where I think the disconnect is here, is that you may have a plan with the military and say, hey, we got it covered. You never have it covered.
So, John, I got to leave it there for now. We could do this forever, as we often do, and we will do it again. When we return, we have got the first of many great Malzberg panels. Stay with us.